Hello and welcome to another IoT Central webinar. I'm David O'Hara and I'm the Managing Director at IoT Central. I'd like to start by thanking Ground Control for sponsoring today's event. The title of today's webinar is, What is Direct-to-Device Satellite IoT? I'd like to introduce our speaker. Oliver Potter is the COO at Ground Control. Oliver, when you're ready, let's get started.
Thanks, David. It's great to be here again on IoT Central. For those of you that haven't watched any of our other webinars, this is the fifth in a series of six. So you can go back and look at the others and look forward to the sixth one coming soon. So I'm Ollie Potter and I'm the COO of a company called Ground Control. We specialize in satellite IoT and satellite tracking. And today I'm really here to talk to you about direct to device and what does that mean? Let's sort of demystify the term and let's explore, kind of particularly in an IoT context, what that might mean. So let's jump straight in. First of all, let's just unpack why satellite. So cellular is brilliant. It covers all of the populated areas on the planet and delivers brilliant coverage. But that doesn't reach, I think it's something like 80% of the planet is covered by water or big land masses where there aren't lots of people and there isn't cellular coverage. So that's where we turn to satellite, and satellites can provide 100% of the Earth's surface covered with a data service or a voice service. And that's been around for a number of years. So kind of first thing in direct to device or satellite direct to device is, what's the point in satellite at all? And ultimately it's that you can connect your device anywhere in the world. So moving forward and kind of looking a little bit more deeply. So on the left here, you know, what we're really focusing on, or what the term directed device is really focusing on, is starting to connect everyone's smartphones. So the idea is you have your smartphone like my one here, and it will work outside of normal cellular coverage. And it will be able to connect to a satellite in order to provide a number of different services. So some emergency kind of messaging services, building up to kind of more normal messaging services, to possibly a data and voice service out there as well. And then really on the back of that thinking, we're then looking at IoT devices, and what if the networks are there and they're serving smartphones, we could also use those same networks to deliver IoT services. And then on the spectrum side, there are a number of different approaches going on here. So I'll start at the kind of top left and then work around the wheel. So on the top left, there are a number of operators in the world looking at using the spectrum that mobile operators already have. And they'll change the use of that so that then it can be used from a satellite and then broadcast down over that country to provide a service from that satellite. That requires you, as a mobile operator, to give up a little bit of spectrum for that use. You have to then work with the regulator in order to change the use of that, so it's no longer on cell towers, it's on satellites. And then you can provide that service. Now, obvious limitation of that is it will only be over that particular country where that particular operator has the rights to give up that bit of spectrum. So the classic example of this, that also the leading example is Starlink and SpaceX. They've announced they're using the T-Mobile spectrum over the USA, and I think they've announced 9 other countries as well around the world. And when they get that ready and when they've got the right permissions, the intention is to use some of that T-Mobile spectrum to provide that data service to devices across the USA. Moving around the wheel, unlicensed terrestrial spectrum, a number of people have tried it. This is sort of using UHF, VHF type frequencies or LoRaWAN type frequencies and using that in a satellite context. It's in here for completeness, but realistically in direct to device, I don't think there's any kind of project using it. And then the bottom one is then a really important one, and kind of particularly in an IoT context. So there is the spectrum that's available all around the world that's dedicated for the use of satellites, kind of MSS spectrum it's often referred to. And that spectrum is the L band or S band, and that's sort of the 1 to 2 gigahertz, which is a really nice sweet spot to provide low power, high coverage with enough data throughput in order to provide IoT devices. this is where your sort of global stars, Iridiums, and Viasats operate in today. And in direct-to-device context, these operators are kind of particularly Viasat at the moment, and I think Iridium coming fairly soon after, are looking at also broadcasting a standards-based cellular data service, so a narrowband IoT service, using some of their existing spectrum in order to provide that service. Now that has the obvious benefit that it would be a global service available everywhere, leveraging their existing satellites that they've already got and that spectrum. So a mixture of approaches underneath D2D to provide that service. So kind of really looking at how it works. So out of the gates initially, looking at smartphones in particular, Apple really went first. So they signed a deal with Globalstar, and they've used a proprietary technology, so Globalstar's existing technology, and included that in iPhones for the last couple of years. That's definitely direct to device, but they've done it in a kind of bespoke proprietary way, where I think all of the mood music around IoT is in standards-based solutions, which is on the right-hand side of this slide. So there are really the two that we talked about before. So these are the at the top are the sort of the narrowband IoT plays from Viasat and Iridium, Skylo. There's a bit on the Ligado network. There's a bit on Thuraya. So there are a number of these starting to crop up to form a service. That probably next year or the year after starts to become something that can be considered. And then at the bottom, as discussed before, SpaceX, Starlink from SpaceX, are looking at using T-Mobile, for example, and using their spectrum over the USA. I think there's operators in Australia and Canada, and I think there's one in Switzerland, for example, where that service will start to come about. Obviously, the drawback of that is it will be a bit patchy. The advantage being it will be a bit faster than the narrowband IoT, so you'll have a bit more throughput and a bit more data, but only operating in some places. Just moving us forward. So why is that interesting and potentially exciting? So because realistically, there are already satellite services all around the world. They provide a great data service already. Why is this interesting from an IoT context? So probably the first one is cost. It's difficult to understand exactly how this will play out, but the big motivation is probably on device cost and device price. So there are obviously modules and chipsets made in the millions for cellular IoT. And if those same chipsets can then be used in a satellite context, then the sort of the scale economics of the devices will mean you could have cheaper devices. And that's definitely a motivating driver to do this. I think we're talking about somewhere between release 17 and release 19, depending on which network it is, in order to support the new narrowband IoT networks. But in the coming years, I think there are some early chipsets available now, but yeah, in the coming years, you're really starting to look at the availability of those. Scalability is, well, if you've got an existing IoT solution, you're already using, say, a uBlox or a Quectel module, you could then scale your rollout really into kind of areas around the world, and not having to do that with any change, having to adopt any new hardware, having to adopt any new set of standards. And then, of course, you know, you've then got improved reliability as well, because you potentially have the option to, if the cell tower is down where your device is, it could then hook up onto the satellite rather than just not be available for that period of time. So kind of clear advantages. Some of these are similar to the sort of broader satellite IoT advantages, but kind of device cost is probably the main one where we and I think the market hopes that there'll be a material improvement as we go forward. So use cases. Many of these are the sort of normal use cases around satellite, particularly focusing on the sort of the lower bandwidth ones. So where you've got a very small amount of data, where narrowband IoT could work for it, we're looking at these. So in the agricultural space, when you're just reporting a moisture reading or controlling a valve, you could easily see narrowband IoT could work quite well there, very little data needing to be moved. Likewise in oil and gas, just monitoring equipment, but only really monitoring kind of binary outputs rather than looking for a kind of greater feed of information. Utilities, there's lots of sensors and switches around which could leverage this as you go forward. In the oceanic space, there may be some. We're seeing probably more higher bandwidth use cases than that, looking for more data and more sensor information that might be beyond narrowband IoT. But again, there may be really good, powerful use cases there. And as I work across the slide, of course, there are use cases in sort of remote telemetry space as well. So typical use cases, but probably at the smaller amount of data end, because it's narrowband IoT and it only has a certain amount of throughput that you can leverage and use. So kind of then to unpack this in a different lens. So you already have your proprietary networks. Realistically, from a D2D perspective, Globalstar is the only thing there, but it's just not really true in an IoT perspective, because Globalstar is embedded in the Apple iPhone. But from an IoT perspective, there's the Globalstar simplex network. There's the Iridium SPD, IMT, or Certus 100 network. There's the Viasat OGX network. So in a proprietary sense, kind of not D2D, that's the landscape that there is today. Really, it's the middle and on the right hand side here. So there's the 5G NTN, so the narrowband IoT side. This is offering, you know, low data rates, slightly higher latency than you would otherwise have. Partly because they're on geo, but there may be some LEO options that come down the line as well. And then on the right hand side, you can get a higher throughput. So Starlink, AST, Link are all planning to offer Cat 1 services. So I think you're looking at, I don't know, sort of 2 to 4 megabits of capacity over a sort of 50 to 100 kilometer diameter radius that would be shared between all devices and all users in that space. So you could potentially see some reasonable throughputs. It's danger of congestion, and until this is up and running and we're seeing observed behaviors and real pricing, it's hard to tell. But you could see quite interesting Cat 1 or Cat 1 biz use cases in those particular geographies, leveraging those networks. There isn't a service yet, but you know, we're keeping a very close eye and looking to start to test that and then be ready to kind of support our customers in that space as well. If we're lining these up and kind of consider the timeline, so Globalstar and Apple got out the gates first. And as I'm sure many of you know, you get the satellite symbol on your iPhone if you go out of cellular coverage and you've got a modern iPhone. And that's been around for a couple of years. I think the next kind of major move is partly the Viasat and Skylo network. I think realistically that's in the middle of next year or early next year, so in 2025. And it'll be very interesting to see when we start to see pricing and when we start to see that kind of coming out, what we might be able to do with it. So we're quite excited about what we might be able to do with Viasat with our customers. Starlink. AST and Link probably on a similar-ish timeline. I mean, this is really starting to look into the crystal ball. Starlink, I think, will be first. Starlink will be first in those 9-ish countries. You can look them up on their website. The USA, Canada, Australia are certainly significant ones in that space. And that will be a Cat 1 biz type service available just in those geographies. So if you're global, wouldn't work. But if you've got a use case in one of those countries, it's potentially an option. Again, yet to see pricing, yet to understand how that will work, but it's lovely that it could come with a Cat 1 biz standards-based service. And then on the far right, Iridium, they've kind of announced they are significantly investing in this. I mean, what that brings, and they will go down the narrowband IoT route like Firesat and Skylo. What that will really bring is a LEO play to the narrowband IoT, so filling in the polar coverage and giving that kind of truly global solution there. So that's the timeline. You can start to test it next year, start to play with it, But I think we're looking for a couple of years before you'll really have that kind of confidence to go for a bigger rollout when the networks are there and when the pricing is understood to build up business cases. But of course, it's not all about D2D. So I get the slide to build. You know, the TCP/IP option is really restricted to Starlink and those plays. So if you want a global TCP/IP or UDP/IP play, then you're definitely going to have to use one of the existing services out there. So Certus 100 or the IoT Pro, which is the new name for BGAN M2M. If you want larger message sizes, then again, you're really going to have to go down one of the bespoke routes. So I think it would be much more cost effective, and actually the services are really designed for that. So I think SBD is similar edge to where you might be with narrowband IoT, but certainly the Iridium message transport or OGX options, if you want to transmit a bit more data in a message way, that would be the way to go. And then of course, the standard, so the bespoke networks have been designed ground up with satellite in mind. You have the global coverage and you really have the sort of the low power benefits of them. They're not trying to retrofit a service to work on a satellite, which is used to having being plugged into the mains. These are designed for it. So we do expect, you know, better power performance and larger messages from the bespoke place. So, you know, lots to go for that with the existing networks that are already out there. So kind of concluding, D2D really promises a lower cost of hardware, and that's the main thing here. You're using modules that are being manufactured in the millions rather than in the sort of tens of thousands where you are on the bespoke side. So we're expecting a lower cost of hardware from that. Lower cost of airtime, probably. It's hard to tell. We've not seen any pricing yet. Everyone's getting excited about it, but the physics don't change. So the business model changes a bit, but the physics don't change. You've still got the same satellites, they've still got the same spectrum, still got all the costs that sit there. So it may bring prices down. It may bring a bit more transparency around pricing and the ability to roam between networks, but I don't think it's going to have a significant impact. And then, of course, you've got this sort of improved interoperability. But you've got great solutions already. So and they're tightening up their pricing. So I actually think the difference will be even smaller when D2D gets there, simply because the networks will want to preserve their existing businesses and make sure they are truly competitive. So even if you don't want to go down a D2D route, I think it's a good thing anyway, because it will improve what's already out there. And of course, you know, there are loads of things that you need to think about when you're going down a route here. You know, what service is available and where in the world? You know, can you work with that protocol? Do you want to use messaging or TCP/IP, and are you happy to use those? If you've got a lot of data versus a little bit of data, that will drive your decision making. And then again, power, how much power have you got? Can you afford to run a higher power service? And all of these are the sort of things that we would go through with any of our IoT customers looking at any particular rollout. So that's everything I had to say. If you've got any questions, email us, give us a call. But that's the end of my webinar, and I'll hand it back to you, David. Thank you.
Thanks, Oliver. This brings our webinar to a close. I'd especially like to thank Oliver for his insights, and thank you to Ground Control for sponsoring today's event. You can view more webinars at iotcentral.io. Thanks for watching.